KCC.
Morning, Brent.
Oh, that sounds loud. Good. You're all awake then. It's a wonderful morning. I trust you are all well. We're about to start the morning off with a bit of worship, but before we do that, let's just prepare ourselves. If you've got your Bibles, please crack open the Old Testament. Yes, I know. That's the bit that's all a bit stiff and unused. Go to 1 Chronicles 16. It's David's song of praise. So from verse 8 onwards. Oh, give thanks to the Lord. Call upon his name. Make known his deeds among the people. Sing to him. Sing praises to him. Tell all of his wondrous works. Glory in his holy name. Let the hearts of those who seek the Lord rejoice. Seek the Lord and his strength. Seek his presence continually. Remember the wondrous works that he has done, his miracles and the judgments he uttered. O offspring of Israel, his servant, children of Jacob, his chosen ones. Let's just pause there for a moment and note this. Romans 11 says, and now us Gentiles that have been grafted in and share from the same nourishing roots. Amen. So that speaks to us as well. He is the Lord our God. Amen. Amen. His judgments are in all the earth. Remember his covenant forever. The word that he commanded for 1,000 generations. Amen. Yes. Amen. The world is a mess. Without doubt, we've just seen over the past week so many things happening. And also we see the continuing conflict in Israel as well. You know, but, as we've just heard, Israel, his servant, children of Jacob, his chosen ones, the Lord is looking out for Israel. And as Christians, we stand and we pray with Israel. So I'm going to ask Pastor Rob now to come and lead us in just a short prayer for what is going on in Israel.
Amen, church. Let's just bow our heads and our hearts one more time. Abba, Father, we just want to say thank you for your son, Jesus. And thank you that we can come to you, Lord. We can approach your throne of grace this morning with confidence and with boldness, Lord. And Lord, you have invited us, Lord, to pray and to partner with you, Lord, as we see your purposes working out in the earth, Father. And Lord, there are so many things that we see and we do not understand, Lord, but you know all things. And Lord, as we see now, Lord, the carnage, Lord, coming out of Gaza, Lord, coming out of the Middle East. Lord, as humans, our hearts are broken. Lord, we see the suffering. We see the victims, Lord, on both sides, Father. But we know that you are the God of Israel. That you have a covenant that you established with Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob, and the descendants thereof, Lord. And we just thank you, Lord, that you are faithful to the covenants that you established, Lord. And so, once again, we pray for Israel, Father. We pray for the protection of the state of Israel. We pray for its leaders, that they would be wise, Lord, in how they move forward. Lord, so many of us, we do not understand the dynamics and the challenges of that region, Father. And Lord, so many are basing their understanding upon what they're seeing on the media, Father, on the news channels. But Lord, I pray for Benjamin Netanyahu and the government, Lord, that you will give them wisdom as they move forward and they will do what they need to do, Father. Lord, we pray for minimal casualties, Father God, on both sides, Lord. We pray for all the innocents that are caught up in this, Father God. Lord, those who are fleeing for their lives, Father, we pray that your hand would be upon them, that they would find safe refuge, Father. We pray for the correct humanitarian aid to reach these people, Father God. Lord, supplies that they desperately need, Father, that the sick would be attended to, the wounded and the injured would be attended to, Father. Lord, we pray for that, Father God. We pray for the IDF soldiers that have been tasked Lord, with going into Gaza and putting their own lives upon the line, Lord, to eliminate this evil. Lord, we pray for them. We pray your hand of protection be upon them today, Father. We pray for every single hostage. Lord, the hostages that seem to have been forgotten by so many, Father, in this conflict. Lord, you know exactly where they are right now. And Lord, we pray for their freedom, Father. We pray for their release, Lord, their safe release, Father God. In whichever way, Lord, that you bring that about, that they will be released. We pray for their families as they wait for news, Father. Lord, every day, Lord, it is torturous for them. Oh God, look upon that ancient people. Look upon that ancient land, Lord. You have known this ancient conflict, Lord, and we're seeing it today. Just as your word prophesied would take place, Lord. Lord, we commit the whole situation to your hands, Father God. And Lord, we look to the day when the Prince of Peace will return from heaven.
Amen.
The Sar Shalom, the King of the Jews, the Messiah of Israel, the Savior of the world.
Hallelujah.
And will come and return and establish peace in the earth, peace in the nation of Israel. And will rule from Jerusalem, Father, just as your word prophesied. We look to that day, Father. In Jesus' name.
Amen.
Amen. Amen.
And on that note, church, let us stand to our feet if we're able and worship the Lord. Amen.
tithes and our offerings, Lord. So I just ask, if you're visiting today, please feel free to give. Thank you, Lord. If you could just bring your tithes and offerings this morning into the basket at the front as we sing, I see the King of Glory coming on the clouds and the fire. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus.
just as we were singing that song, I just felt the Lord impressed on me that actually, for a few people here today, that song is more than just a song, but actually it is a desperate cry, a desperate prayer. Lord, heal my heart. Lord, break my heart for what breaks yours. Lord, show me what you want to show me. So right now, actually, I'm going to ask Grace if they can just sing that verse a couple more times. And if that is you, cry out to the Lord, because he will hear your prayer. If you need healing, cry out to the Lord. Say, Lord, heal me this morning. He will hear you. If there is something that is blocking you and God, cry out to the Lord. Say, Lord, move this boulder out of the way. Whatever it is that's blocking that thing between me and you, cry out to the Lord this morning. He is faithful and he will answer.
Amen.
morning.
We give you all honor and glory and worship due to your name. Lord, we lift your name above all other names. Lord, you are the King of Kings, Lord of Lords. And we give you all due, all honor and all praise. Amen. 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 And Lord, we thank you for these offerings this morning. Again, Lord, we do not give out of spirit of fear or of service, but Lord, we give out of love. Love, Lord. And so, Father, we ask that these gifts given here today, Lord, those that are given online, be used for your purposes, for your kingdom. In the name of Jesus Christ. Amen. Amen. Hallelujah. Thank you, worship band. Oh, praise the Lord. I'm excited this morning. Are you excited? Yes, the Lord is doing something today. And it's a wonderful thing to see. Shortly we're going to have Pastor Paul. Where are you? I don't know you are, Pastor Paul. He's going to be coming and bringing the word. But for the moment, we're about to take communion. But the children are going to be leaving us to go and do whatever it is they've got lined up to do. So let us quickly just pray a blessing over the children here today. Father, we give thanks for these children. Lord, we give thanks for the joyful noise that they make in the house of the Lord. Father, long may your children's praises sing out here. Lord, as they go out, as they go and learn about you, Father, bless them. Bless their leaders as they teach. Lord, in the name of Jesus, amen. Amen. Hallelujah. Where are we? Let's transpose ourselves over to the table. Oh. I'm going to take communion together, and I love communion. It is something that just every day I can do it, and I enjoy doing it. As we come around the table today, we need to remember these powerful words of Jesus. Do this in remembrance of me. Remembrance is an important aspect of our life as a Christian, as our walk as Christians. As believers, we are encouraged and strengthened by remembering the faith and the deeds of those that have gone before us. We remember that ours is an ancient faith. You know, it goes back so much further than Jesus. We remember the promises of God's word. And as we do so, our confidence is built. Our trust in God is strengthened and affirmed. Amen. There are several places in Scripture where we are constantly reminded to remember. You know? But the commandment from Jesus, spoken on the night he was betrayed, sends out an even more powerful message. There is a deep and vibrant meaning to this instruction. And this remembrance, this table, continues to be a cornerstone of our faith. Amen. We've already been in the Old Testament this morning. And we have to remember that events in the Old Testament serve the dual purpose of fulfilling God's promises to his people, but also providing a glimpse of what is to come. Amen. And this occurs in one of the most obvious of these as Jesus fulfills the meaning of Passover. Here we see Jesus commemorating, observing, and remembering what God has done, while simultaneously, if I can speak English, simultaneously revealing what God is doing and will do. Just as the blood of the Lamb covered the doorposts, the blood of Jesus covers our sins. Amen. Amen. The disciples would certainly observe the meal again. You know, we see it in Scripture. As would the entire nation of Israel and the church to come, to today and onwards. But Jesus is now adding a deeper meaning to it. As we remember freedom from physical slavery, we also remember the sacrifice of Jesus that frees us from spiritual slavery as well.
Amen.
Yes. Now, we could spend all day contemplating and remembering all that Jesus has done for us. And there are times that we have done that. There are times that we've had those extended periods of communion, of reflecting and remembering. And those are wonderful times. But we're not going to do that today. Not this time anyway. Maybe another time. But we're going to play a video in a minute. And as this video is playing, I would like you just to stop and remember what it is that Jesus has done for you. I'm going to ask Les and Marge to come and hand things out while the video is playing. But yeah, just take a minute to remember. Okay?
Jesus coming.
And Jesus, he took bread, gave thanks and broke it, and gave it to them saying, "This is my body, given for you. Do this in remembrance of me." Amen. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. Likewise, he also took the cup after supper, saying, "This cup is a new covenant in my blood, which is shed for you." Amen. Thank you, Lord. Hallelujah. Amen. Amen. Father, we just say thank you for the table and all that it represents. Father, we thank you for this time of remembrance as well, Lord, so that we can focus upon you. Amen. Amen. Are you ready to hear from God again?
Yes.
Do you want to hear him even further?
Yes.
Pastor Paul, come forth, bring the word of the Lord for today. We have faith in the Lord.
Morning.
Morning.
just trying to find out how to switch it on.
That's what I was looking for.
Good morning. I have no idea what's happening to me right now at this moment in time. I'm sitting in the service, we're worshipping God, and we're crying out the way. I just feel the presence of God, he's here. And he's humbling. Just that Yeshua Adonai would come from his throne in glory and come and be with us. It's amazing. You've all come here expecting, haven't you?
Well, that's three of you at least. Do you know, folks, this morning I just want to kind of have a real great conversation with you. I just sense that there is something powerful happening in church like we were up in Denby. You can't get any farther from here, from Denby, North Wales, to here. Yet the same spirit that was on in that meeting a couple of Sundays ago is the same spirit that is here today, and it's the Holy Spirit. And we want to glorify Jesus. We want to magnify Jesus. We want Jesus to be front and center of everything that we do. And I think we have to, as God's people, come to a place where we hunger for that more than we do of all the frivolous things of church. It's great that you're here. It's great that you've come. But if you've come for any other reason than Jesus Christ, you will be disappointed at some point in your life. What a great encouraging message this is going to be this morning. Yeah? But I'm just telling you the truth. If he's not at the center of your life, if he's not the reason why you are sitting where you're sitting, folks, we've got to ask the question, what is it? What am I doing here? Now, pastors won't allow me to preach this message because they may think it entered the church. But here's the thing. We need people on fire for God. And that's not just doing things. It's not about doing things. It's about being the people of God. I just wonderful just to feel the Holy Spirit's presence here this morning. Proverbs 3 says this. Trust in the Lord with all your heart. Lean not on your own understanding. In all your ways, acknowledge him, and he shall direct your paths. There's more heads nodding here. He shall direct your paths. Folks, we are either in a living kingdom or we're not in a living kingdom. And we need to really emphasize the life of the kingdom of heaven in us. It's an amazing thing. I'm going to talk about the kingdom of heaven if you haven't guessed. I want to talk about the kingdom of God, the kingdom of heaven. In the Bible, something like 46 times the words the kingdom of God or the kingdom of heaven is mentioned. The vast majority of those are in the New Testament by Jesus himself. And I began to read those. We're reading through the New Testament and I was just struck by it. And I thought, I just couldn't get away from the fact that what is the kingdom of heaven? What is we hear about it, your kingdom come. Yeah? And we talk about the kingdom. What is it? What does it mean to us? And I want to explore this profound and transformative concept that lies at the heart of Christianity. That is the kingdom of God. I know we should pray for peace. Please understand me. I know we should pray for peace, but you are the peace. I'll say that again. You are the peace. If he lives inside of you, you are the peace. You are the one who is bringing the light of the glory of God to a world that so desperately needs it. Not by the words that we say, but by the life that we live. Are we perfect? No. That's the amazing thing of grace. We can still carry on day by day. And we can come to him and we've got that wrong. And he says, it's okay. Because we need to have a kingdom mentality. Matthew 5 verse 3 says this. Blessed are the poor in spirit, for theirs is the kingdom of heaven. Blessed are the poor in spirit, for theirs is the kingdom of heaven. And the actual translation of that verse... And that's Jesus calling. just letting me know that I'm on the right track. If anybody else has not switched their phone off, just leave it on, because it might just, you know, ring at the right time. The word blessed are the poor in spirit, for theirs is the kingdom of heaven. Those that have never tasted of the heavenly gift of grace and mercy, when they taste of it, they're no longer poor. And the kingdom of heaven, God says there, the kingdom of heaven is theirs. It's an incredible thing. This divine kingdom is not just about a distant, abstract idea. It's a living reality in our world today. And I think many of us, I don't know, until I started to read this in the New Testament, I suddenly thought to myself, Lord, I'm really sorry. I've never really comprehended what the kingdom of heaven is. It's not some place that we're all going to in the future. Well, it is some place we're going to in the future. Amen? You could have done better than that, but that's okay. Oh, God bless you. Yeah? If you're not sure, come and see us. It's not something that we're just waiting to go to. It's now. It's living. It's powerful. It can reshape communities. It can reshape the lives of people. And it's not about being religious. Hallelujah. It's about being the people of God in the midst of the darkness that surrounds us. I used to pray, God, take me out of the darkness. He says, I can't, because you're the light in the darkness with me inside of you. Amen. The kingdom of God is a vision of hope. And if we ever needed hope, we need it today. I kind of had this moment, I must have had a filter on my TV screen eyes, you know. And everything that I looked at, I thought, it's going south. It's going to pot. The government's not doing it. The MPs are not doing it. The world's not doing it. The church is not doing it. And I'm looking at this thing and saying, what is happening? And I think there's rising up a people of hope. A people who want to share Jesus, not by the things that we do, but how we are in our everyday lives. When you take that time to just help somebody across the road, you know, or you do something that, you know, today people, oh, that's silly. You open a door for somebody, you help somebody. You just show in the smallest of ways a concern for another human being. It can reshape a community and it can reshape our world. Is it possible for the world to be reshaped? Yes, when the Church of God understands what it's got in its arsenal. When the church understands what the kingdom of heaven is. So let's just begin by looking at the definition of the kingdom of God. In the Gospels, Jesus spoke of the kingdom of vision and of hope that offers liberation, transformation, and eternal life. When he talks about the kingdom of heaven, he's talking about those things. We can no longer be in the same state once we've come into this kingdom, because the Bible says that we've been translated out of the kingdom of darkness into the kingdom of light. You are children of light. Have a look at the face of a person next to you and just check that the light's on. If you answered no to that question, we can either do CPR or we can pray. No problem. But the kingdom of God is a vision of hope, a new way of living and relating to people, other human beings. I remember when I first got saved, nobody taught me any of this. It was just get saved, notch on the belt, carry on, this is what you have to do. And they made sure that I was beaten with my sin. You shouldn't do that. I can remember as a young Christian, it's a long time ago now. I remember as a young Christian, I think it was Jane and I, we went to see Jaws at the pictures. I mean, it was heavy stuff in those days. We were living on the edge. And I can remember, I was all excited, it was a great film, especially at the end when they sort the shark out. Yeah. And
The pastor's wife on the Sunday morning came to us and said, "Oh, how was your weekend?" "Yeah, oh, we went to see Jaws at the pictures." Twenty-five minutes later, I remember her conversation. "Well, that's not a place for a Christian to be." I didn't know anything, so I'm going, "Really? I shouldn't do that? No, 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 you shouldn't do that. You need to keep away from the world. You know, don't worldly things." "This was the advice?" "Yeah, yeah." "Oh, okay, yeah. So you need to repent and, you know." Because ask yourself this question: if Jesus came back, what would you do? And at the time, I hadn't got an answer to that. I wish I could see her now. Because if you're in the pictures when Jesus comes back and the trumpet sounds and we're all, you know, we're on going to that kingdom of heaven, happy days, whether you're in the pictures, whether you're in McDonald's, you know, or anywhere else, you're going. There's going to be smoke in the shoes, hole in the ceiling. God. Boom. Why? Because you're living in a new kingdom. You're living in a kingdom of liberty. You're living in a kingdom, not to excess, but you're living in a kingdom where God says, "I can do something with these people." I'm just looking across your smiling faces right now. I hope in a 20 minutes time it's still there. But here's the thing. You know, the kingdom of God is liberating. And how we relate to one another. It's a realm where God's reign is fully established. I can remember looking up years ago a definition of the kingdom of God, and this is my simple version. It's the rule and reign of God in any sphere at any time. All the theologians now. It's the rule and reign of God in any sphere at any time. So what does that mean for me? He's in charge. He's front and centre. He's the one that's controlling my life. He's the one that should be, not my will, but his will be done. You know, he's the one who's doing that. We find in the glimpse of the kingdom, in Jesus uses parables where he describes, for example, a mustard seed. The kingdom of God is like a mustard seed. It's the treasure hidden in a field. It's a pearl of great price. These images invite us to recognise the immense value of the kingdom of heaven. Just bear with me a second. Number one, greatness is created over time. And I don't mean greatness where we are arrogant and proud, but the greatness of his glory is displayed over time, like a mustard seed. The smallest of seed, but when it grows and grows and grows over time, it gets bigger and bigger. Do you want Jesus to get bigger and bigger in our communities? Amen. Then you're the seeds. You're the seeds. Allow him to grow in his kingdom. It grows and grows and grows. It's fantastic. And greatness comes over time. Persistence in seeking God. We are in a society that wants everything now. Everything. We've got a 7-year-old granddaughter. Her name is Naya Grace. My granddaughter is unique. She's unique. And she was diagnosed with high autism. Not autism, Asperger's. That's the one. I know it began with an A. She's incredibly intelligent. Let me just share with you the intelligence of this 7-year-old. She's only 7. I said, "Naya, why are you making such a mess in your bedroom?" Answer from Naya: "It's easier to make the mess than it is to tidy it up." I am biting my lip not to laugh in front of her because it wasn't the right answer. But she wants everything now. As many of you know, we're moving house and after 25 years.
Oops.
That's what I said when I collapse out of the loft. All the stuff we've got. But Jan's got this little DS thing, Nintendo DS thing. It's the first editions, for those of you who don't know. Yeah, I didn't want to say that to her. Right? And she got this, she never used it. So she says to Hannah, I'll give it to Naya. Hannah tells Naya, Nan's got a DS. And you'd be like, what's the game they're going to put in?
Animal Crossing.
Does anybody know that?
Yeah.
I have no idea what you're talking about. But anyway, she's on the phone, Grandad, you've got to bring the Nintendo DS now. I need it now. I've got it. My life's falling apart and I don't have it now. You don't get it, I'm not kidding. This is how it goes. We're trying to console her because she hasn't got the Nintendo DS thingy. Now. People are living in a world where they expect everything now. There's no persistence in seeking God. Oh, if God comes into my life, he's going to tell me to stop doing this, and this. It's going to be boring. Let me tell you, I've had the most exciting life that you could ever have. Pastor Rob and I, we drove across a mountain with a 1,000-foot drop in the pitch black in a minibus. You don't get much better than that. I'm saying, Rob, right, I can't see right. I'm done, I don't care, but if you go this way, then good. We had some great times. Living in the kingdom. The kingdom, there's a great price to pay for living in the kingdom. You know, people will laugh at you. People will mock you. People will call you names. They might even beat you for being a Christian. But let me tell you this, the kingdom of God is bigger than that. The kingdom of God is greater inside of you. I just read the stories in the New Testament of the Apostle Paul, who was beaten with rods, stoned, left for dead for the kingdom, for the glory of the kingdom. The kingdom mattered to him because the kingdom is the kingdom of the king. I'll practice that one. It's about commitments. We don't hear much about that in the kingdom anymore. But folks, we've got to get away from all the doing and start to be the being the kingdom. And that's just being in love with Jesus. Allowing Jesus to come in your every day, every moment. The kingdom is within, but it's manifested by our actions. Is that okay?
Yeah.
Thanks, Rob. The kingdom, there's a present and a future tense to it. The kingdom of God is present now because you are here. And God is here. Jesus said the kingdom is among you. Luke 17:21. The kingdom of heaven is among you. How can it be among us? Because he is. We sang the song, he's risen, he's alive. What's that song that we just sang? The cowboy, I call it the cowboy song.
Yeah.
He's alive. No, not that one.
Well, that's what
it means. I'm singing a different one. Yeah, we just had one and I thought it was great. I said to Jane, I haven't heard this in like 20 years. What was it?
Running to Canaan.
I was just enjoying the song. I thought, yeah!
I went back to
But it's present now because he is here. It can be experienced now. The values of the kingdom are love. And when we say that, everyone goes, oh. Let me tell you, love is one of the most powerful things, especially when you're loving your enemies. Especially when you're loving those who are unlovable. Especially when you're living or working with people that revile you and hurt you and speak ill of you, and you just choose the way of love. That's the way of Christ. That's the way of the kingdom. Justice. One thing that keeps me sane is this. Will not the God of all the earth do right? And there is a day coming when he will do right. I've just got to show his glory and his love to all of those around me until that day. It's not only that. The kingdom is about his presence with people. It's in you and it's yet to come. Compassion. Compassion. You know, compassion's missing from a lot of things we see in our world today. But folks, I'm here to plead with you today. Be compassionate. And it doesn't necessarily mean how much money you give. Be compassionate with your time. Be compassionate with your conversations. Be compassionate with the love of God inside of you for every human being that you meet, because you may be the only Jesus that people are seeing. And are they seeing the kingdom in there? Love, justice and compassion are actively at work in those who choose to follow Christ. The kingdom empowers us to be agents of transformation. I like this. I want to be an agent. I want to be a 007 three quarters of transformation. I don't want to be just, oh yeah, that Paul is a nice person, James is a nice person, Rob is a nice person. I don't want to be known as a nice person. I want to be known as a person of transformation. I want to influence you. I want to mess with your heads. I want you to love Jesus more than I've ever loved him. Because I know that he's the answer to whatever you're facing right now. Whatever situation you are in, trust in the Lord with all your heart, lean on your own understanding, in all your ways acknowledge him, and he will direct your paths, because the kingdom is alive and is active. How do you enter the kingdom? I've learnt a new word. You all ready for this? It's Hebrew. I think they're playing with me. You enter the kingdom of God by, we call it repentance. And it's a harsh word, isn't it? Yeah, it's a harsh word.
Repentance. Turn, you sinners.
Yeah? The Hebrew is teshuva. You want to say that with me? 1, 2, 3.
Teshuva.
Now say it like you mean it. Hosea 14:2, come, let us return to the Lord. When I read this and I did a bit of digging about teshuva, I was blown away. Because teshuva says, I'm actually going to change the way that I think and the direction I'm walking, but I'm not turning away from my sin. You are. I'm not turning away from my sin. I'm actually turning back to God because I want to. Wow. Because I want to walk to him. I want to run to him. Teshuva deals with the sin issue, but it doesn't focus on the sin issue. It focuses on the one that you're returning to. The story of the prodigal son, it focused on the return back to the Father, and the Father was waiting with open arms. And I'm here to tell you today that Jesus is waiting with open arms for you to have a teshuva moment and come back to him. Change your thinking and walk towards him. In fact, why don't you run? Jesus said in Mark 1:15, he declared, the time has come. The kingdom of God has come near. Repent and believe the good news. I'm here to tell you that the kingdom of heaven is good news. It's not just about getting you saved with a notch on the belt and a ticket to heaven. He wants to be part of your everyday decision making. I'm trying my hardest to learn to listen to the voice of the Spirit in every angle of my life that I possibly can. And it's a battle, because my mind wants to take over. I want to do this. I'm going to try this. I'm going to try. If I'm trying something, yeah, it ain't God who's doing it. If I'm doing it, God ain't doing it. And I need to get to the place of yieldedness. I need to have a teshuva moment, and I need to come running back to God and say, I need to run to God. I don't need to run to religion. I don't need to run to a church or a denomination. I want to run to God Almighty, the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords. He's my King. Faith is equally essential. It involves trusting in what Jesus has done. We just celebrated it. Yeah? Yeah. One day we will have a proper Passover meal that lasts for about 4 hours. Yeah? To understand the significance of what Jesus said in those few words. Jesus Christ, who reconciles us with God and invites us into his kingdom, through faith we become citizens of a new kingdom. You were once in darkness, but now you're light. Isn't that an amazing thing? Get back on. Sorry about that. It's an amazing thing. You were once darkness, but now you're light. Help me out here. Turn to the next person and say, are you in the kingdom? Go on, I dare you.
Are you in the kingdom?
I'm in the kingdom. Are you in the kingdom?
I am.
Are you sure you're in the kingdom?
I am.
Praise the Lord. We live by the principles of the kingdom of heaven, the rule and the reign of God, in any sphere, at any time. When we think that events in our world seem in chaos, I rest in this one thing. He's still on the throne. He's still there. I can pray for the peace of Jerusalem, and we should. And I can pray that God will root out evil, and he will. And here's the thing. Through faith, I've become a citizen of a kingdom. I looked at my passport photo this week. I thought, I've seen that face before. It's called Crime Watch. I looked at it and I thought, my goodness me. It says here, Paul Raymond Pearson. I don't know if I can give my middle name. Paul Raymond Pearson is a citizen of the United Kingdom. And I thought, they're lying. I'm not a citizen of the United Kingdom. I'm a citizen of heaven. And I'm going to live my life with the kingdom principles working in me. And every day I get it wrong, God's grace and mercy is coming. I don't have to go out to get it wrong. But the power of the kingdom will transform our society and our neighbourhood. You all okay for a little while? Living in the kingdom. Once we enter the kingdom of God, we're called to live according to its values. Jesus summed the entire law up by saying, you shall love the Lord your God with
all your heart, all your soul,
and love your neighbour as yourself. And those, everybody's going, love the Lord your God with all your heart, with all your soul, with all your mind. Love your neighbour as yourself. That's the sum total of the kingdom law. We are not called to berate. We're not called to criticise, condemn or complain. And we do that easily, don't we? There's about six heads nodded in church today. We're telling the truth. Yeah? We do it. But it's not a kingdom value. A kingdom value is, you know, love your neighbour as yourself. So if you're not loving your neighbour, have a guess who else you don't love? Yourself. And actually, the one who lives inside of you, his name is Jesus, you probably don't love him either, you know, because you're not doing what he said. Love is the heartbeat of the kingdom of God. We're called to love not only those who are easy, we're called to love those who are a little more difficult. That was very politically correct, wasn't it? Yeah. Furthermore, the kingdom is a place of service. My friends, my dear friends. Jesus said this, whoever wants to become great among you, let he must be, or she must be, your servant. All those in favour? Not too many hands going up. Because we equate service with doing something for other people. And that's true. It is. But here's the thing. You're not doing it for other people. You're doing it for the kingdom of heaven. You're doing it for Jesus. You're doing it because it's the right thing to do. Servanthood and service are much lacking. Now, I'm not talking about upstairs, downstairs, or Downton Abbey type service. Yeah? I'm not talking about that. I'm talking about what can we do as a group and a company and a gathering of people that the world will look at us and say, that's amazing, I want to be part of that. We serve one another. We help one another. I rang a brother up, lastminute.com. I said, any chance you can come and sort my internet out? Because it's driving me mad. He'd had like a massive long day, worked hard, and said, yes, Pastor, I'll be around in half an hour. And we came, and I watched in awe as this thing happened. It was just plug something in. Yeah, that's okay, all the wires are lined up. I'm thinking, you can tell that from a bit of kids. Where can I get one of them? That looks really good. Tell Jane that I really need this. Fantastic. Then tested the other end, and it was still as good. And then, the PS de resistance, he said, oh, let's have a look at the... Got his laptop out. I connected it to my internet Vodafone don't buy it account. And I'm going, whoa, fingers moving across a keyboard. What are you doing? I'm pinging. No, what are you doing? Whoa, code. It was on the Matrix. Bang, done. He didn't hesitate to say yes to helping me out. Didn't hesitate. That's the kingdom at work. Even when you get put out and you do something, I think God smiles. God smiles. We need everyone, not leadership, not deaconship, not eldership, none of them. We need everyone in the body to be working together with a common good. Now, I know you know this because I know you're very intelligent. I'm almost finished. The word conclusion is coming. Here's the thing. I know you know this. If every one of you just spoke to, loved, and discipled one person, the church attendance would double overnight. Just one. You all do one. You talk to one. Pray for one. Fellowship with one. Discipleship with one. The church would double overnight. You see, we've relegated these things to specialists. Well, the evangelist got to do. Well, I'm an evangelist. Yeah? I'm a pastor. Oh, the pastor's got to look after me. No. Right? I'm a pastor. Pastor Rob's here. Let me tell you this. I'm trying to frame this so it doesn't come out wrong. It's not my job to pastor you. It's not my job to feed you. It's your job. I might come along now and again and have a great time and encourage you. That's great. That's fantastic. We like that. Yeah. And then we've got teachers and stuff. All that's going on. Fantastic. Have I got 30 seconds for a little cul-de-sac? I'm really sorry. I used to hate teachers. Even when I was a Christian. I'm confessing it. I couldn't stand teaching. Especially when they look about 5 years of age themselves and they're teaching my kids, you know. We had some not nice teachers. And I had a real problem with it. Until about 10, 15 years ago, I'm in the middle of delivering this site manager's course to site managers, you know, about 12 of them. And I'm really giving it large, I'm going for it. And I heard this little voice say to me, Paul, I'm right here. And it was God saying to me, you know that thing that you hated? Yeah, you've become. The kingdom changes you. sometimes you don't know how much the kingdom changes you. It's, the kingdom is an inside-out kingdom. Jesus presented another parable to them saying, the kingdom of heaven may be compared to a man who sowed good seed in his field, but while he was sleeping, the enemy came and sowed tares among the weeds. Again, a little bit of research here. You know the story. And the servants come and say, shall we tear up the tares? Shall we rip the tares out from among the weeds? And the owner said, no, let them both grow together. This is what the kingdom is telling me. There will always be conflict with tares that are sown in your life. But eventually God will separate the tares and the wheat out. The kingdom will be pure. The kingdom will be his kingdom. But he can't do it right now. And the tares grow with the wheat. Yeah, the weeds. I say tares, weeds. Can I call them weeds? Because everyone is like weeds. It grows together with the wheat. And as they're growing, it's almost indistinguishable which is wheat and which is the weeds or the tares until the harvest. And then when the harvest comes, they're separated. And they have to separate them because the tares, the seeds in the tares are poisonous. And they can do a lot of harm. And that's why they're bundled up and burnt. But folks, sometimes we're going to have conflict, we're going to have difficulty as we're growing in the kingdom. But you just stand fast to that God's in control of my life. Amen? Right, in conclusion, the kingdom of God is the divine revelation of God's reign, love, justice and grace. It's a vision of hope that offers transformation both individually and collectively. I want to become a kingdom person. It's both a present reality and a future promise. To enter the kingdom, we must repent and have faith in Jesus Christ and allow him to come and take up residence inside of us. As we leave here today, think about the love, the justice and the compassion of the kingdom, the values of the kingdom. If you are living those values, you are being and not doing. Is that okay? Any questions? The multiple choice paper will now be given out. Folks, we're going to pray. Yeah? But I'm not going to ask you to bow your heads, close your eyes, put your hands together. I want you to have an open expression right where you are. If the kingdom of God resides inside of you, then I implore you, live with those kingdom values every day, and you will see a change in your community, in your home, in your place of work, in your place of residence. Begin to live with those. And if you've messed up during the week, the Bible says, I can come to him who is my advocate. And I can ask for God's forgiveness, but I need to learn the lesson not to do it again. Live with the kingdom. Be kingdom with other people. Help one another. Love one another. Support one another. Not just on an hour and a half on a Sunday morning. It's Monday through Sunday. If people are in need, go help. It may cost you something. It may cost you some time. It may cost you, you know, that you couldn't go out and enjoy that steak dinner that you so much planned for. But if somebody's in desperate need, folks, let's be the kind of people that reach out and help and do. The kingdom of God is the rule and reign of God at any time and in any sphere. So I just ask you this simple question. Who is ruling you? Shall we just stand to our feet and we'll just pray together? Is that okay? If you're able. If it's okay to do so, and it's appropriate and right, just place your hand on somebody's shoulder. We're going to pray for one another. Amen. Just pop your hand on somebody's shoulder. or hold their hand, whatever you want to do. Father, I thank you this morning that the kingdom of heaven is here. Manifestly, the kingdom of heaven is here. I pray for my brothers and sisters that they would live a life of love, justice, compassion, and peace in the knowledge of you. And if any of us need a teshuva moment where we need to turn around, run back to God, ask his forgiveness, then I pray that you will do that right now. I pray that you will accept the kingdom life as a life worthy to be lived. In the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit, and all God's people said,
Amen.
Amen. Amen. Amen. Amen. You can sit down again now, that's fine. That's fine. Okay. So, having given you the introduction, we will now go on to the main sermon points. It's an honour and a privilege to speak to you this morning. I never take it lightly, you know, because I have to give an account one day before God of how I prepared. There have been times when I've got absolutely nothing, and I get up and I stand and God has given me the word to speak. That's a scary place to be, but it has happened. But I want to do my best for Jesus. I want to be the best version of me I can be for Jesus and him only. Is it okay to be compassionate? Is it okay to be loving?
Yes.
We're not going to criticise and condemn and complain anymore, are we? Amen. Is it over to you guys?
Yeah.
Oh, okay. Thank you very much. God bless you folks.
Should we stand? Thank you.
do. Lift your name on high. Exalt your holy name. Sing out our praises. Sing out our praises to you. And give you all glory and honor and praise. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Amen. Thank you, Pastor Paul, for that word. We pray that it just resonates with you all as you leave today. But before you do leave today, we have some notices. Woohoo! I like notices. Yeah, now. Got a nice full page up there. Ah! Bless the Lord indeed. Right, tonight we have the continuation of the prayer course. For those of you who have been doing it, we've had, I think it's 3 sessions so far, and they have been wonderful. So much information. Denise, did you want to say something about it? Amen. So as Denise said, if you didn't hear, if you haven't been and would like to, please come along. It will be wonderful to see you. Emma, I see you there.
So of course it's our Bright Lights party on Tuesday, and I just want to say a massive thank you to everyone who came and helped and made it such a huge success. I mean, it was just amazing to see the kids running about, having so much fun, and it was all coming up after saying, oh, thank you, you know, so that was just a, it was a blessing. So couldn't have done it without everyone, so thank you so, so much, and here's to next year.
Yes, it was a wonderful time, and much pizza was enjoyed by before, I will say. Right, serious time. Pay attention. Christmas. Now, I got mentioned last week very, very briefly, but that was in deference to Chris and Tris. But so today I'm going to go into a little bit more detail. We've got 2 big events coming up. The first one is the Christmas light switch on, which is happening out in the community, and it's a wonderful opportunity to shine the light of Jesus in the community. The other one is our carol service, which is another wonderful chance to shine the light of Jesus by inviting the community. It's a wonderful thing. So, some things to note. The Christmas light switch on is going to be on Sunday the 3rd of December. Now, importantly, they're going to be closing the road for safety. And the road will be closed from 1 p.m. So, that means we will not be doing refreshments on that day. We will still be having a regular service, but we won't be doing any refreshments. So, in case things go on, you'll still be able to leave. Not that we want you to leave. We do need people to help, because not only is the community doing things, but we want to do things as well. So, we need volunteers. We need those who are evangelists, or those that are good at inviting people and talking to people, to hand out leaflets and gospels, share the light. We need kids workers, those that work on a Sunday, those that work in the ark. Oh, hang on a second. Maybe not, because that's me. No, we do need kids workers, because we've got bags of hope that we want to give out as well to the children. Okay? We need worshippers. Who's a worshipper today? Woohoo! Excellent. So we need worshippers to go around singing carols. Okay, now we're not doing a choir, we're not doing a set performance. Choirs are wonderful, and we give glory to the choirs that we've had. But we just want people to go around singing carols, you know, brightening up the place. So yeah, Kat's going to leave that one. We need servants as well. We need people that are willing to serve, because the church is going to be open as well for people to come and use the toilet. We're also going to be offering free teas and coffee, a place to sit down, almost very much like a warm welcome that we've been doing. By the way, we're doing warm welcomes on every Friday between 1 till 4. Another notice set in there. So yeah, it's a wonderful way to go out into the community and serve. And I know, because I work with the community group, they are so keen to have us involved. They're looking forward to seeing us, especially seeing us sing carols, because that is their favourite point of it all. For the carol service, again, we need help for people putting things away, setting things up, all the rest of it. We need help in the kitchen. We've got a fantastic kitchen team, but the carol service is so much more. We are having turkeys from Newey's that's going to be cooked and everything, but we still need to put them all in cobs. other things need to be put together. So yeah, we need people on the door welcoming people again. We need people inviting people. It's no good putting on a carol service for the community if we don't invite the community. Amen? Excellent. So that's what's happening. Come and speak to us. Let us know how, when you want to serve. Amen? Amen. Now I'm going to pass over to Rob because he's got an announcement he wants to make. There we go.
I'm actually going to preach the second part of the sermon now. Now, just before I give this announcement, just wanted to say, on the back of what Pastor Paul brought today, you know, we're seeing a lot of stuff on our television screens, aren't we? And you're seeing such manifestation of anger and hatred and division and misunderstanding. And I don't know about you, but it's messed with me a lot. You know, it's stirred my heart a lot. And it's so easy to get caught up in that, isn't it? And just, you know, during the weekend, the Holy Spirit has really just been ministering to me, reminding me, you know, we're in the world, but we're not of it. We belong to a different kingdom with a different set of values. And so we need to have that kingdom perspective. Yes, we can't. We're not ignoring what's going on. But we've got to be, guard your heart. Guard your heart. And so keep praying. The way to do it, guys, is just to fix your eyes on Jesus. I've asked myself many times, Lord Jesus, what would you be doing? What would you be saying right now with all this going on and stuff? And you know, I can't say right now that I've got an answer, clear answer. But I'm just reminded that we don't belong to the kingdom of darkness, but to the kingdom of God.
Amen.
Keep seeking his face. Just another announcement to give you. Paul gives a wave. Paul's been with us for about 2 months now, haven't you, Paul? About that. And we're really blessed. We've seen him step out boldly and to bring some prophetic words, which is good, because that's what we've been praying for, isn't it? That we start to see the gifts manifest in the church. Praise God. We're going to keep encouraging others too to step out. Those who have been praying, those who have been seeking to step out. But Paul took a big step because he married Jane. There's another Paul and Jane in the church. Jane's not here today. Just to clear up any confusion. So Jane's not with us this morning. We'll see her soon. But Paul got married last Saturday, wasn't it? Last Saturday. Congratulations, Paul. God bless you, my brother. Okay, I'm going to hand over because I'll keep going. Bless you, brother.
Amen. Now, I think that is all the notices, except for Deb. Come on, Deb.
Shoeboxes.
There's more shoeboxes at the back. They're not at the front, but they were at the front. They're hiding behind the cross at the moment. So if you bring your shoeboxes in, leave them at the foot of the cross. There's a message somewhere. The last day for collection next week. So if you don't bring them next week, then see them. I've got the answer. Any other notices? Anyone else? No? Awesome. Well, I believe we do have teas and coffees and things like that. But let me just speak a blessing before you go. Oh, Lord. As you leave today and go through the week, I pray that the grace of the Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit be with you all. Amen. 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 Go be the kingdom of God. Amen.
Our vision is to be a worshipping community at the heart of Kings Winford,
where every home is an expression of the kingdom.
And every believer a disciple of the King.
Our mission is to be obedient to the Great Commission.
Through the faithful proclamation of the Gospel.
And developing, equipping, and sending of disciples.
Welcome to King's Winford Christian Centre.